you.
...1590 WPSL. It's the Christmas Kids Show, a little different this year because everything in 2020 is different. And as Carol likes to put it, we've got the streamlined version of it this year.
Welcome to the streamlined Christmas Kids. Yes, we've had to streamline everything, but going very well so far.
Mm-hmm.
And thank you. We want to welcome back the Sheriff's Department, a recurrent sponsor and supporter of the Christmas Kids. So we'll be talking with Gary Wilson and also Brian Beatty in a little bit.
And we want to welcome also our entertainment portion of this show today, the Palm Point Elementary Kids. And we're going to start our show out with some Christmas cheer from them. Take a listen. Carol, it takes me back, 1590 WPSL. It takes me back to us in that band room the day that we sat there and did our Christmas Kids show. And these students start playing. And I looked at you and Greg looked at me and we're like, what is this? I mean, they were just awesome. I mean, they well beyond their years,
well,
for
you
sure.
Look, junior high kids. I mean, mm-hmm. They're all in junior high school or middle school now. And just amazing.
Yeah, yeah, the great program
Basie,
over there.
Yeah, the classic jazz. Mm-hmm. So we thank WLX for bringing the beautiful music from years past, and especially the jazz this year from Palm Point. And we want to welcome Gary Wilson, who is the chief deputy of St. Lucie County Sheriff's Office, and also Brian Beatty, the public information officer.
Thanks for having us again.
Welcome back to the Christmas Kids. 2020 is a different year. I mean, we're
absolutely
so much, but you're doing a lot of the same things. The shop with a cop is going on.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. We had our first one Tuesday evening with our partnership with Walmart in St. Lucie West, and we were able to give 30 children the opportunity to shop for Christmas gifts for themselves or their siblings. And you know, you find a lot of them that they want to get something for their brother and sister or mom and dad and things like that. And we're a little bit different this year. The flash used to be we'd bring them in a bus with a deputy's escorting them with the lights and siren on, which they all got a big kick out of. this year we didn't want to put them all on the bus just for precautionary purposes, so we had them had the parents bring them, drop them off. They had to be masked up, and we monitored social distancing and things like that, and they got to shop, and we'll be doing another one this coming Tuesday, again with a new batch of kids.
And, you know, one of the interesting things that we've done different this year is how we've partnered with the community to make some of these things happen. Mm-hmm. Spanish Lakes Country Club up in the Lakewood Park area used to always do a big toy drive for us. Well, instead of them all coming together and, you know, complicating social distancing, they hosted a parade through their neighborhood with a giant trailer. And people sat on their in their driveways, and they watched the golf cart parade. And as the trailer went by, they brought the gift that they would have brought to their annual Christmas party, right, and put it on the trailer. And we were able to use those gifts to offset the other siblings who didn't get to participate and shop with the cop. We were able to make gift bags of all those donations so that all the kids in the family could get something this year for Christmas.
I love hearing these ways that people have been able to adapt, mm-hmm, and still do the things, the generous things that they do this time of year.
The creativity has just been astounding at what people have been able to come up with to still be a part of a really good, generous holiday spirit. And it's been all year long. I mean,
yes,
the chief can speak to some of the groups that have just inundated us weekly with food and masks and sanitizers.
Well, tell us about that. Yeah.
As we said, 2020 has been a very, very different year, but the public support that we have seen, the outpouring, whether it's in public, whether it's in a restaurant, whether it's on a call, people thanking us for what we're doing. But we, as Brian has said, we have had weekly donations of food and cookies and, as Brian said, masks and all kinds of different things. And some of them come every week. We have one local person that every Monday we get a couple of dozen donuts dropped off for the office. And every week they just show up and we put it out to everybody in the building that if you want to go by the staff lounge, there's some snacks and things in, mm-hmm, there. So there's been a very, very big outpouring of support for the sheriff's office and I think law enforcement in general.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think people realize, I mean, we're all trying to, you know, we've got the masks and we, mm-hmm, have our disinfectant wipes and staying away from everybody. But if you're, you know, a sheriff's deputy and you're out on a call, you can't always do that.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And we started, you know, as soon as COVID hit and became the national pandemic, the global pandemic that it is, we put protocols in place for those deputies that are going on to a scene so that the dispatcher begins with them and they're asking whoever it is that we're going to interact with, has anybody been sick in your home? Does anyone have a fever? And they're relaying that to the deputy on their way there so they know how to better prepare for that interaction. And, you know, it's as simple as instead of being right in front of somebody when you're asking them questions, maybe you're on one side of the car and they're on the other side of the car and you've got that distancing, but you're still able to do what it is we need to be doing.
And we all know that COVID has changed everybody's lives, every business. How has it changed the way the sheriff's office does their day-to-day business? I mean, that's one of the changes, mm-hmm, I'm sure, but there's probably many changes that you guys had to endure.
Well, that's the biggest change, is all the precautions that we had to put in place for the deputies to be safe, or as safe as possible out there in the street, because they never know who they're dealing with, whether somebody has been exposed and that type of stuff. And as Brian says, we try to really minimize face-to-face contact, mm-hmm, and spacing things out, having people meet us outside the house rather than go into a house, meet us outside in the fresh air so we can gather the information that we need. But for the most part, we still have to do the job that we're tasked to do. Mm-hmm. And we've had to adjust and work around those things and focus on the personal protection aspect of it, because we don't want, you know, the deputies getting infected. And we've had deputies on the law enforcement side and the detention side at the jail that have come down with COVID and thank goodness have recovered and, you know, are back to work. But we're still very, very cautious about introducing it anywhere into the building or the jail.
You know, mornings, more and more, I'm getting emails of these off-the-wall scams, and we talk about it. We make light of it on our morning show, but I wanted to bring a more serious side to this. The scams that always seem to come out around Christmas time. Can you speak to that?
Well, it's always an opportunity to come up with some angle that you're going to try and exploit people, whether it's the porch pirates that, you know, they follow a UPS truck around or a Amazon truck around. They drop gifts off at a house in the front porch. They drive off. Somebody pulls up. They run up, grab the packages off your porch, and take them away. Those are things we try to combat. And, of course, we try to get the public involved to, you know, make sure that someone is there to pick it up and get it inside as quickly as possible and things like that. But you're always looking out for that. And then there's those people that either through email or text message or phone calls and things come up with some holiday-themed approach to try and get money out of victims and everything. And, you know, we always say that if you don't know who you're talking to or it just doesn't sound right or it's too good to be true, don't take the call, hang up the call, and move on. Report it to us, especially if there's a number that we can track down. We want to be aware of all of those things as well to protect the public. No matter what, pandemic, holidays, there's people out there that are looking to take advantage.
And pretty much, if it sounds too good to be true,
right,
it's a scam.
Yeah, or if it just doesn't sound right, we're never going to ask you to pay for a traffic ticket over the phone. We're never going, just like the power company is never going to call you and threaten to shut off your power over the phone.
In the next 30 minutes, I got one of those calls, you know, and you think, wait a minute.
Exactly, exactly. And most importantly, they're not going to ask you to pay anything with a gift card that you have to go to Walgreens and buy. So it's just that weird feeling. If you get it, just hang up.
I always get the email where a person just inherited $10.5 million and wants to give me some of it.
Right, right.
And all he wants is my account number and my email and this. And I'm like, what?
Yeah.
That's it.
Wow.
Too good to be true.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let's check in again with Palm Point. It's the Middle School Jazz Ensemble. Thank you.
1590 WPSL. Oh, wow, there's me at the end of that.
Yes, we remembered this.
Yeah, what a great jazz band Palm Point had for there.
And how stunned we were that these are our junior high, middle school
kids. And the bass guy let me actually sit in. Prior to the show starting, I grabbed this bass because I played bass back in the day, and I sat there and I'm like, hey, yeah, I can do this too, you know. It was fun, though. It was fun being with them. Yeah.
Well, we are talking with Gary Wilson, Chief Deputy of St. Louis County Sheriff's Office, and also Brian Beatty, Public Information Officer. Now, what people may not realize, we see the deputies and the cars in the field. People may not realize how big an operation you also run the jail for St. Lucie County. Now, things have to be quite different there as well.
They're extremely different at the jail, and one of the first things that has had a large impact on the court shutdown. You know, when the pandemic first hit and the numbers started going up, they closed all the courthouses down. So that meant no movement of cases, no sentencing, not sending anybody off to state prison and things like that. So we had to deal with that. We also had to deal with people who were unfortunately coming in contact with a deputy. They might have warrants or have committed a crime. They come into the jail. Well, now we've got to be very careful about who they get near until we're sure that they're clear. So they came up with a very thorough process of quarantine dorms where you would come into custody and you'd be placed in a dorm where they could monitor your any symptoms, check your temperature regular basis, and make sure that you were not showing any symptoms and things like that. After you finish there, you'd move to another dorm, and we continue to monitor you, but we don't want you with the new people that are coming in because we've got that time distance in there that we didn't want to disrupt. So we'd move on and go there. And if you were clear after that point, you could go to general population. You could be put in regular housing unit with other inmates. And we were checking the dorms on a regular basis to make sure that it didn't somehow get into the jail. At one time, we had, I believe, about 27 inmates were COVID positive. But those people were in a medical dorm where they received their treatment in the medical dorm to get them through the COVID. And we worked very closely with the health department as far as getting them tested so we knew who had it, who didn't, you know, who was in incubation and things like that. So it's been very, very complicated, but they're doing a wonderful job out there. Of course, all of our programming had to stop. Mm-hmm. So our religious programs had to stop. Our drug abuse programs had to stop.
Adult education,
things like that had to stop because we didn't want to introduce more outsiders mm-hmm. into the jail. Everybody who shows up at the jail gets their temperature checked. They get the universal questions, you know, are you showing any symptoms and things like that, just to protect the jail because you just don't want it to spread through the jail. It could be a just terrible situation if it spread outside of what we've been able to do. So that's working out. So we are getting to the point, if the courts have opened up again and we're starting to see some movement and we're able to move some people out to state prison and do things like that, and we're hopefully tentatively next week we're going to start back with video visitation so families can get back in touch with their family members or friends that are in custody. That's especially important with the holidays coming.
Yes.
So that they can have that contact. They always had phone contact, and our phone vendor actually gave, and I don't know if it's still in force, but gave free time to inmates. They could get a couple of minutes a week no charge to be on the phone so that they could connect with their families and let them know they were okay and or if they needed anything and that type of stuff. So it's been probably as tedious there, just in a different way, as what the road deputies are having to contend with on a regular basis.
The holidays have always been a difficult time to be guests of the sheriff mm-hmm. In the jail. but you've always done a little bit for the holidays, or a group has. I mean, that'll continue this year differently.
We have a very wonderful volunteer clergy team that comes in regularly and speaks to the inmates, and they provide service, religious services and things like that. Of course, all of that was closed down. And around the holidays, of course, they always came up with a special package, a holiday package that went to the inmates. My understanding is that even though that the pastors can't get into the jail, they are going to put the packages together, and we'll take care of getting them distributed, where they would come in and distribute them, you know, and share their thoughts with the inmates and things like that. So we're trying to keep as much as what is normal, and have those types of things. But there are just some things that are too dangerous to, or risky is a better word, not dangerous, risky to introduce something into the jail where it could spread and we could have more cases of COVID.
If there's anyone who wants to help with anything along this line, whether cookies for deputies or, you know, something to be included for inmates, is there a way to do that? Or?
Certainly they could call the office at Midway Road, and we can direct them from there, whether it's something maybe for the Department of Detention or whether it's something for the deputies at Midway Road or a specific, it might be the school resource people who, of course, are back in school with reduced classroom sizes, but they're there, they're doing their jobs each and every day, and we will make sure that whoever is they would like the packages to get to, or the gifts or thoughts. I mean, we're getting cards and things like that, just showing support. So if all they'd have to do is contact us at the main office on Midway Road.
Okay, and I think if we hear one more Palm Point, and then we'll come back and briefly favorite holiday memory.
Point Jazz Band, Let It Snow, Let It Snow, Let It Snow.
And
yeah, wishful thinking.
Speaking of that, favorite holiday memory, Gary Wilson.
Well, we were just talking during the music portion of the show about how long it's been, 14 years that we've been having these shows, right?
The Sheriff's Department, you know, we used to go out to the jail, and then now lately we've been going to the Sheriff's Department on Midway, yes.
So those 14 years, and of course our listeners don't want to hear my same stories all the time, you know, because we've covered most of the younger years in 14 years with the shows. But just looking, I think, just what we've talked about today on the show, I think one of the things that is going to stick with me is the way that the outpouring from people during the pandemic have been in support of law enforcement and bringing the gifts that we talked about and the different things like that, and the well wishes that we get all the time from the public that we haven't seen, you know, in a long, long time. And I think when we're past this, and hopefully we'll be past it in the next year or so, this will be one year that I'll never forget, having been in this position, you know, in law enforcement for as long as I have and seen the ups and downs for law enforcement. The outpouring has just been incredible, and I think this year will be one of the memories that will probably last the longest just because of the support we've seen.
Yeah, that's a great point. I think that everyone's kind of making new memories this year that they'll be able to think about for quite a long time. But mine is always that, you know, for years and years, we spent Christmas Eve with one grandparent and Christmas Day with another. And, you know, both those grandparents have since passed. And, you know, the families have gotten bigger and now do their own things. But that's always a memory of mine is, you know, Christmas Eve with one grandparent and Christmas Day with another. And sharing that time with family.
And thank you both for being with us again with the Christmas Kids, and certainly thank you for your support of the Christmas Kids for all of these years. Thank you very much, and keep the Christmas Kids in your heart. We will see you again tomorrow, right here.